vanishes from the face of the earth. His last communication, a suicide call to 911.
Yes, Philip Taylor Kramer, I'm going to kill myself.
But his loved ones think it may have been foul play.
He told me, he says, if I ever say I'm going to kill myself, don't you believe it.
The incredible story behind the mysterious disappearance of Iron Butterfly bassist Philip Taylor Kramer. And the saga of the king and queen of punk rock, Sid and Nancy.
Sid really couldn't remember killing her.
Was the death of Nancy Spungen an accident or murder? New theories may uncover the truth about the Sex Pistol and his punk princess.
This is what makes me very suspect of the theory that Sid killed her.
Plus, Tim and Jeff Buckley, a father and son who barely met, share parallel lives and deaths.
And for the father and the son to both die that young, it was just horrific.
And later, is Elvis still alive? These people swear they can prove it.
We found Elvis Presley's handwriting on FBI documents, dated after his death.
Has Elvis really left the building? Judge for yourselves. These are the myths, the legends, the forbidden truths of rock and roll. This is VH1 Confidential. When it comes to rock and roll mysteries, there are few that stand out like the death of Iron Butterfly bassist Philip Taylor Kramer. Kramer's story began on a rock and roll stage, but ended tragically. What happened to this musician-turned-scientist is a mystery with a heart-wrenching twist, and it lingers without resolution. You may have loved it, you may have hated it, but in 1969, if you owned a radio, you couldn't have ignored it.
In a garden of a fleet of honor, don't you know that I'm loving you?
Iron Butterfly's In a Garden of a Fleet of Honor was a huge success, a hit song that perfectly fit the times. But sudden fame and non-stop touring would prove to be a bad combination for Iron Butterfly. And in 1972, they split up. But just 2 years after the band's breakup, an enthusiastic bassist and singer named Philip Taylor Kramer convinced Iron Butterfly to reunite. Drummer Ron Bushy credits Kramer with motivating them to record again.
In my mind, I see a mirage.
We got an album deal with MCA and put out two albums, Scorching Beauty and Sun and Steel.
But despite Philip Kramer's best efforts, the comeback stayed back. Dropping his first name, Philip, Taylor Kramer decided to change more than his name. He kicked the music habit and went in an entirely new direction, moving from rock and roll to rocket science.
After Taylor got his electrical engineering degree, it was around the time that aerospace was just booming. Taylor went to work for a team that designed the inertial guidance system on the MX missile.
Taylor's inspiration came from his father, with whom he had worked on physics projects his entire life. As a physics professor, Taylor's father struggled for 30 years to do what was considered impossible, to communicate or send information through gravity waves. Taylor, who by now had become a computer genius, took his father's theories one step further. Remarkably, he was close to putting the final touches on this new form of communicating, sending messages literally through space. He was about to unveil these secrets to the world.
We were working towards trying to find something faster than the speed of light.
Something that would totally revolutionize the way we communicate today and travel. To put that in a nutshell, we're talking beam me up, Scotty. That's it.
As Taylor came closer to the answers he was searching for, he became totally consumed and distracted, working endless hours, depriving himself of sleep.
He hadn't slept for probably 10 days to 2 weeks before his disappearance. when you're sleep deprived, and as my brother was, I think that he just mentally got where things were very stressful for him.
No one knows if what happened next was a result of his mental state or of something more sinister. On February 12, 1995, Philip Taylor Kramer took a routine trip to Los Angeles International Airport to pick up a friend. But before the friend even deboarded the plane, Kramer mysteriously vanished from the airport. No one saw Taylor Kramer at LAX, but a parking record proves he was there. He signed an IOU to pay the $3 fee he didn't have with him and drove away. During the next 45 minutes, Taylor made several calls from his cell phone. He called his wife, his father, his friends, and he told all of them the same thing.
He said, "Bush, it's Taylor. I love you more than life itself, Bush." And then he hung up.
At 11:59 a.m., Taylor made one last call, a call to 911.
This is 911. Can I help you, sir?
Yes, you can. I'm going to kill myself.
Okay, what is your name? Hello? Hello?
That was the last communication we had from him. And it was my brother's voice. I've heard the tape, and it was definitely my brother's voice.
This is 911. Can I help you, sir?
Yes, you can. I'm going to kill myself.
Hello?
No one ever saw Philip Taylor Kramer alive again. But to Taylor's father, Ray, the 911 message was not exactly what it seemed.
Well, Taylor had told me a long time before there was people giving him problems. They wanted what he was doing. And he didn't want to give it up. And several of them had threatened him. And he told me, he says, if I ever say I'm going to kill myself, don't you believe it. He says, I'm going to be needing help.
No suicide note. No body. No van. In spite of that, and of the forewarning Taylor gave his father, the FBI believed he committed suicide. His family and friends thought otherwise.
When I think of my brother as committing suicide, I can't picture him doing it. And my brother would not have left his family.
He did 1,000 sit-ups in the morning. Nobody's going to kill themselves and do 1,000 sit-ups first.
The Kramers grasped at any bit of hope they were offered, but their hopes were dashed countless times over the years. Only one thing was certain. Taylor Kramer and his unique scientific knowledge and research had vanished. Philip Taylor Kramer, the Iron Butterfly musician turned scientist, was nowhere to be found. He had been working on a revolutionary method of transporting information and matter through space, a discovery his family believed was so valuable that Kramer had reason to fear for his safety. When Kramer mysteriously vanished during a trip to Los Angeles Airport, those fears may have been realized. The only evidence left behind were a series of phone calls, some to family, some to friends, and one to 911.
911, can I help you?
Yes, this is Philip Taylor Kramer.
This is 911, can I help you, sir?
Yes, you can. I'm going to kill myself.
Okay, what is your name? Hello? Hello?
Investigators concluded this was a suicide. But Kramer's family refused to accept their findings. They believed that there was foul play, and that perhaps those who knew about Philip's discoveries were somehow involved in his disappearance. However, the only thing that Taylor's family really knew was that their loved one was simply missing. For over 4 years, they continued their search for answers. On the afternoon of May 29, 1999, some of their questions were finally answered. The Kramers received incredible news that both brought them relief and broke their hearts. In a canyon a few miles away from Los Angeles Airport, hikers stumbled upon a van. Inside the van were human remains. After a few agonizing days, dental records proved beyond question that the body found in the van was that of Philip Taylor Kramer. One part of the mystery was solved, but another was only beginning.
We were under a lot of hope that possibly my brother was alive somewhere, or that maybe someday we would see him again. But now it opens up more questions, and we need to know what happened to my brother.
A few days after the grisly discovery, his sister Kathy visited the place where her lost brother had finally been found.
This isn't what they would call a suicide cliff. You don't necessarily die going off. There were some teenagers that had stolen a car and they were trying to dispose of the evidence and went down and actually got out with just cuts and scratches. So this is not the type of a mountainside that would guarantee that someone could die.
This raises the question, did Taylor Kramer drive off the cliff to his death, or was he driven there already dead?
The only thing that this has closed is chapter one of suspense, because the suspense part as to where is he and the wondering part is over. But it's just the beginning.
Every day, the family asks themselves, was it murder, suicide, or an accident? In spite of their continuing search for answers, the truth may never be uncovered. For Kramer's sister Kathy, music is the bond that keeps her brother's memory alive. She even wrote a song called Brother, My Brother, in his honor.
Oh, brother, brother, where can you be?
He's missed very much by his family and friends. There isn't a day doesn't go by that I don't think of him. Often.
A lifetime of feelings and memories. Oh, brother, brother, where can you be?
The antique people are down.
Their names were Tim Buckley and Jeff Buckley. And never has the expression, like father, like son, been more appropriate. Two singer-songwriters, two untimely deaths, a father and son who met just once, but followed each other from life into death.
For the father and the son to both die that young, it was just terrific.
Singers see and poets wail.
In the 60s, Tim Buckley's beautiful voice made him a folk music favorite on the East Coast scene, reminding rock archivist Michael Oakes of another great folk artist.
I took one look at him and he said, that's like a good-looking Bob Dylan. I mean, he was like a real pretty boy. You know, the same kind of curly hair, and the voice was just to die for.
In 1966, at just 18 years old, Tim met, fell in love with, and married Mary Guibert. Soon after, they had a son. However, just as quickly as the romance blossomed, the marriage fell apart.
We both had choices to make at that crossroads in our lives. And I can understand how an 18-year-old might want to just sort of turn the page and not look back at his past.
Tim went on to record 7 albums, and while he was a critical success, he was never a big seller. Eventually, he dropped out for a while, earning money as a taxi driver and a chauffeur. Tim Buckley returned to music with a new direction and a new album, Greetings from L.A. Once again, critics loved it, but fans didn't buy it. While Tim experimented with his music, he also experimented with drugs. And while his friends never thought he was a junkie, they were aware he dabbled in heroin. On an ordinary summer afternoon, Tim's experimentation would prove to be fatal. In June 1975, Tim Buckley's lifeless body was found at the foot of the stairs to his apartment. When first examined, signs pointed to foul play, even though autopsy reports would later confirm that 28-year-old Tim Buckley died of a lethal combination of heroin and alcohol. Police tried to track down the person who had supplied Tim the drugs, and they had a lead, a UCLA medical student. And while the student claimed it wasn't his fault that Tim OD'd, he was charged with second-degree murder and served 4 months in prison for involuntary manslaughter. Tim Buckley left this world without much fanfare, but his musical talent wouldn't die with him. It was passed on to the son he barely knew. For in 1991, another Buckley would emerge on the music scene, Tim's son, Jeff. Jeff Buckley was only 8 years old at the time of his father's passing. Yet sadly, he had only met his father once before Tim's untimely death. Despite his absence, music would play a major role in Jeff's life, a role that his mother says he forged all on his own.
People think that Jeff inherited his voice or his music from Tim or from me. And I'm here to say that that young man was all about music, all on his own, all in his soul.
Jeff's talent would take center stage in a 1991 tribute to his father, a tribute he had heard about and wanted to be a part of. He contacted the show's organizers, Hal Wilner and Danny Fields, asking if he could perform. Both, never having heard Jeff's music, were skeptical about his abilities, but honored his request.
We had heard about him. We had heard that he had a son. Somebody told us that he was better than his father.
I didn't know what Jeff looked like, and I was terrified that he would come and perform and I wouldn't know it was him.
Yeah, of course, the romantic vision of it was pretty amazing. And also, we waited till the middle of the show to put him on.
Then the lights went on, and there was a performer lit from behind, and the spotlight just went across his cheekbone, and I said, I gasped, and he started to sing, and it was the voice, and it was the face, and it was really a spooky moment.
Jeff Buckley blew the crowd away. He looked like his father and sounded even better. Danny Fields, the director of publicity at Elektra Records during Tim's heyday, was shocked by Jeff's talent.
It's not like he studied vocalizing with his father. He didn't know him.
His two albums would go on to sell much better than his father's music ever did. But in 1997, at just 30 years old, Jeff's life would also end tragically and prematurely. More than 20 years after his father's death, Jeff Buckley disappeared.
I got a phone call from the Memphis police telling me that he was missing. And, you know, it was such a shock. It was unbelievable. I was sure that they just weren't looking in the right place.
Jeff Buckley was missing, last seen swimming in the Mississippi River. Friends and family agonized for days as authorities combed the murky waters.
If you've ever been at the spot there in front of the marina, it's such a placid place in the water. It doesn't look dangerous. He just didn't know how unsafe it was there.
6 days later, Jeff Buckley's body was found floating down the river. No drugs or alcohol were found in his system. It was simply a death by drowning in a most unlikely place.
Just don't drown in a river. You don't think of a river as being, you know, a deathly threat, but who knows? There it was.
I'm probably one of the only moms in rock history, one of the few anyway, that has a coroner's report that says there were no drugs and no alcohol. Did you say, no,
this can't happen to me? Two musical voices from the same family, silenced too young. The beautiful folk singer who never achieved stardom, and the son who was on the verge. Today, this wife and mother's only hope is that father and son have finally forged a relationship in death that eluded them in life.
They both had the courage to follow their art and to be who they were. And I know that they're together now and that they understand each other now.
In the late 70s, they were the quintessential poster couple of the punk rock movement. Sid and Nancy, a combustible combination that would end in tragedy. Nancy Spungen murdered in a seedy hotel room. Her boyfriend, Sid Vicious, charged with her murder and then overdosed before the trial.
Well, the big myth about Sid and Nancy, of course, is that they had a suicide pact.
More than two decades later, this central question remains. Did Sid kill Nancy and then kill himself? But this sordid tale of sex, drugs, and punk rock is scattered with other mysteries and myths. Stories that run the gamut from drug overdoses to mental institutions to an even stranger urban legend that followed Sid's death. The legend of Sid and Nancy continues to be one of rock and roll's greatest unsolved mysteries. Sid and Nancy were two of the most controversial figures that emerged from the punk rock scene. Sid Vicious was a self-loathing punk rocker from the Sex Pistols. Nancy Spungen, a New York runaway, prostitute, and devoted groupie. Legs McNeil, co-founder of Punk Magazine, remembers them as two extremely damaged human beings who were made for each other.
Nancy was a self-professed groupie on the New York punk scene who was desperate to find herself a rock and roll boyfriend. And when she didn't get one in New York, she went to London and she hooked up with Sid Vicious.
According to Eileen Polk, a photographer on the music scene who befriended her, Nancy had the perfect calling card to get in with the band, drugs.
She made no effort to hide this. She also made no effort to hide the fact that she had earned the money to buy the drugs through prostitution.
When Nancy brought her punk rock trophy home to New York, she gloated about her conquest.
She had finally made it. She came back from London with a rock star, and a famous rock star.
I think they were in love, you know. I think they really were in love with each other. But they became the famous couple, Sid and Nancy.
Sid and Nancy's relationship was bound by drugs, and Sid's usage started to take its toll on the Sex Pistols. Eventually, Nancy was forbidden to tour with the group, driving a wedge between Sid and the band's frontman, Johnny Rotten. It was a situation that would lead to the group's ultimate demise in January 1978. In the aftermath, Sid became despondent.
When the Sex Pistols broke up in San Francisco, after their last show at the Winterland Garden, Sid consequently flew back to New York and overdosed on the airplane and was admitted into the hospital.
It was just the first in a series of drug overdoses. Sid eventually recovered and was released from the hospital, but Sid and Nancy's drug habit had spiraled out of control, and in order to feed their habit, Sid played high-paying gigs at the punk rock club, Max's Kansas City.
And Sid was extremely high. Consequently, the shows were really horrible. You could see Sid standing up there, well, actually kind of teetering up there because he was always nodding out. It was really, really sad. It was really tragic.
By the middle of 1978, Sid and Nancy spent most of their time in a drugged-out haze in room 100 at the Chelsea Hotel. They even developed a penchant for playing with knives in bizarre bloodletting games. But those games may have turned deadly. For on October 11th, 1978, the couple's warped fairy tale romance would end in tragedy. Nancy Spungen was found dead in their hotel bathroom at the age of 20.
Nancy died from a knife wound to the lower abdomen. It was apparently about an inch wide, and she bled to death. And there was a trail of blood leading from the bed where she was sleeping or lying with Sid to the bathroom. And she was found dead on the bathroom floor.
According to Sid, he had passed out cold from an overdose of downers called Tuenols, only to wake up to find Nancy face down in a pool of blood. Sid claimed to have no recollection of how she got there, but police weren't so convinced. With Sid as the only witness, the myths surrounding the murder of Nancy Spungen were born. Did Sid kill his beloved girlfriend in a drug-induced rage? Did Nancy die accidentally in some twisted, dangerous game? Or was there some other explanation?
The people who I know who talked to Sid and asked him what had happened said that Sid really couldn't remember killing her. I think he would have. You know, even if you're in a blackout, I think you'd remember stabbing your girlfriend in the stomach.
But with no witnesses to back up Sid's recollection, the rumors began to swirl. The main one centering on a drug deal gone awry.
I heard that the night Nancy died, she was making phone calls to try and get drugs delivered. I also heard that she was claiming to have lots of money and offering anyone who would deliver drugs a lot of money. And this is what makes me very suspect of the theory that Sid killed her, because there was no money found in the apartment the night that she died.
And Eileen theorizes if Nancy did have large sums of money in their apartment, she wouldn't have shied away from a threatening situation.
I think that if someone showed up that night at the Chelsea and tried to rob or threaten Nancy, that she was the type of person that would have fought them. Nancy was not afraid of anybody.
But police already had their suspect. On October 12, 1978, Sid Vicious was arrested for the murder of Nancy Spungen. He was booked into Rikers Island and was later released on $50,000 bail. His trial was set for a later date. Accused of murder and his girlfriend gone forever, Sid became distraught again. An attempted suicide took him from the jail cell to a padded cell, Bellevue Mental Hospital. Sid survived his second overdose, but as soon as he was released, he found himself back in Rikers after a bar fight. But Sid would get one last chance. Released from prison, he was finally determined to get his life back on track.
When we picked Sid up at the courthouse, he looked really good. You know, he looked very healthy. He really looked a lot better than he had at the time when he was performing at Max's.
While the murder charge still hung over the fallen punk star's head, Sid tried to put his life back together. He started by settling in with a new girlfriend named Michelle Robinson. On the night of his release, Michelle, Eileen, and Sid's mother, Ann Beverly, planned to celebrate with a dinner in Sid's honor. The relaxing dinner ended when a knock at the door brought drugs crashing back into the life of Sid Vicious.
I could tell as soon as these people arrived that drugs had arrived, because all of a sudden people were going into the bathroom, looking around in bags and drawers for stuff. What had been kind of a calm, relaxing end of a dinner turned into something different, and it became unpleasant. All of a sudden I see this kind of shadowy figure stumbling in the hallway. And I went down the hallway and into the bedroom, and I saw that Sid had collapsed on the bed. And so I knew that he'd taken some drugs and he'd overdosed. They took blankets and wrapped him up and started rubbing his shoulders and shaking him, going, "Sid, Sid, you know, wake up." And all of a sudden he came out of it. And the first thing he said was, "Oh, I'm sorry I scared you all."
Eileen wanted to take Sid to the nearest hospital, but his mother refused, fearing the media circus would land her son right back in jail. So Sid was allowed to drift back asleep. The next morning, February 2nd, 1979, the infamous legend of punk rock was pronounced dead of a heroin overdose, found in his new girlfriend's bed while she lay sleeping right beside him. Sid Vicious would never be tried for Nancy Spungen's murder.
I think the police believed that Sid killed Nancy, but I think that they were looking into other possibilities. The thing that bothers me is that they didn't follow up on those other possibilities. I think that if Sid had lived, they would have had to.
The mystery of Nancy's death would forever remain unsolved. The answers perhaps lost along with her boyfriend's own tragic fate. But beyond these nagging questions surrounding Nancy's mysterious death, there lurks another legend, this one a tale about Sid's missing ashes.
The myth of Sid's ashes, the story was, and I think it was reported in the press this way, that Ann Beverly, Sid's mom, had the ashes in her hand and was running to catch an airplane and spilled them on the runway, and, you know, all the ashes blew away from the jet engine. I remember reading it.
The story has been circulating since the week of Sid's death, but Nancy's friend, Eileen Polk, insists it's patently untrue.
I would really like to find out who made up that story about Sid's ashes being dropped at the airport and swept up by janitors, because that person's a liar.
And Eileen says the truth is this. After Sid's death, Anne Beverly wanted to fulfill her son's wish to lay his ashes next to Nancy. But Nancy's mother wanted her daughter nowhere near her rebel boyfriend, even in death.
She called up Nancy's mother, and she said, "Can we please bury Sid next to Nancy?" And Mrs. Spungen said, "I'm sorry, but it's a Jewish cemetery." It was kind of an excuse. It was just a way of saying, no, we can't have him buried next to her because my family thinks he killed her.
But Mrs. Spungen did tell Anne where Nancy was buried, and Anne and Eileen paid their last respects.
Later on that night, we drove Anne to the cemetery, and it was snowing hard by that time, and she got out of the van and ran off in the snow and climbed over the cemetery wall and scattered Sid's ashes on Nancy's grave.
The punk fairy tale ended on a bittersweet note. Sid and Nancy were together for eternity, but their deaths marked the end of an era, and what was dubbed the punk rock explosion had fizzled forever. Elvis Presley was undeniably the king of rock and roll, ruling the pop charts for nearly 20 years and becoming a living legend. But when Elvis died on August 16, 1977, at the age of 42, the truly bizarre side of his legend began. It's written on t-shirts, printed on bumper stickers, and mocked in the media. Elvis lives. This urban legend has taken on a life of its own, gaining momentum each passing year and becoming a staple of our pop culture. However, there are a few extremists who take this belief to another level. Elvis conspiracy theorists like author Gail Giorgio and Presley Commission founder Phil Acheson still truly believe that Elvis never left the building. Both have dedicated a good part of their lives attempting to prove to the world that the phrase Elvis lives is more than an urban legend. So, for your consideration, Giorgio and Acheson present their case. Exhibit number one, the wax dummy in the coffin.
A lot of it started when the fans went past the open casket. And they said it didn't look like Elvis. The nose was wrong. It looked like a wax dummy. Gene Smith, Elvis's cousin, told me that the coffin weighed about 900 pounds. It was so heavy, he almost fell. I said, "Well, why do you think it was so heavy?" He said, "I think there was an air conditioner in it."
Gail claims an air conditioner was necessary so the wax dummy wouldn't melt while on private display.
Gene, he said he walked up and he said it wasn't Elvis. He said the nose was all wrong. He said he could see one of the sideburns came loose and an agent came over and glued it back down in front of him. He said he saw glue all around the forehead where hair had been glued on. He saw beads of sweat. He said he looked at Elvis's hands and said that wasn't Elvis's hands.
Exhibit number two, the misspelling on the tombstone. Elvis Aaron Presley, spelled with two A's instead of one.
Why? I thought, well, maybe they didn't want to. If you're alive, maybe you don't want your real name on a grave. It's kind of superstitious. Let's not jinx ourselves.
Exhibit number three, the suspicious autopsy.
Baptist Memorial Hospital on the 16th. It was the strangest autopsy ever done. There were federal agents supposedly in the room. They ordered that all autopsy results would be destroyed. They didn't even have the stomach contents examined. Everything possible that you do on a thorough autopsy was done differently on Elvis Presley.
It's our understanding that the people in the autopsy room at that time were made to sign a government form stating they would not repeat what they saw in the room.
Exhibit number 4, the uncovered FBI documents they claim were written by the King after his death.
When we went through the FBI files and other government documents, after August 16th of 77, the supposed death date, we found Elvis Presley's handwriting on FBI documents dated after his death.
Giorgio compared the documents with Elvis Presley's pre-death handwriting samples and claims things match up.
We sent our findings to top-rated handwriting experts. They said, yeah, it is Elvis Presley's handwriting.
Exhibit number 5, the Elvis sightings and photographs.
A tourist at Graceland in December of 77, which of course was months after Elvis died, captured a picture in the pool house, which is right behind the pool, and that had been closed off to the public. So it was a big distance, and he got it with his camera, but he didn't even know what pictures he had gotten until later when he was going through his pictures and he saw something in the door. He had the picture enlarged, and it looked like Elvis Presley sitting behind the door at Graceland.
And perhaps the oddest, exhibit number 6. The phone call Gail claims came from the King himself at 3 a.m. October 10th, 1988. The recipient, Gail, of course, who was in the middle of promoting her book, Elvis Undercover.
Well, maybe you'll be a grandfather one of these days.
Well, I definitely will be a grandfather.
You'll definitely be out?
Gene Smith, Elvis's cousin, heard the tape when I played it for him. He said, it is Elvis.
If Elvis is still alive, where has he gone? These conspiracy theorists claim that Elvis was, and may still be, working as a secret government agent. He had, in fact, been appointed an honorary member of the Drug Enforcement Agency by President Nixon in 1970.
This was an appointment for Elvis to continue working in this War Against Drugs campaign, which Nixon sought his help in an effort to, of course, combat drugs on the youth of America.
What better way would Elvis Presley have to get to some of these people than give the appearance that perhaps he was a drug user? That's not unusual either for someone that is doing undercover work.
These Elvis diehards believe the appointment was more than just a goodwill gesture, that Elvis had serious law enforcement aspirations.
I think Elvis had pretty well decided toward the end of what he considered to be the end of the career to leave the music business and pursue his astute interest in federal law enforcement activities.
And yet, an even stranger story has emerged that may call their evidence into question. This man, Bruce Nelson, claims he actually saw Elvis's body during a botched attempt to steal it. It's a story that he has understandably never spoken about until now.
A man came to me, approached me, and told me he wanted some people to help him get Elvis's body and deliver it to his godfather, who was supposedly going to be at the ice house behind the cemetery. So they arrested us and charged us with trying to steal Elvis's body.
A body he claims was definitely the King's.
I saw the man dead in the funeral home. I mean, I know that was Elvis in the box. I mean, I grew up with Elvis Presley. I know he was dead.
But the true believers won't be swayed, and proof, they say, can be found in one of the numerous tabloid photographs. In fact, they're so convinced, these conspiracy theorists say he'll be making a comeback in the near future.
We would anticipate that a coming out would be best warranted and best happen sometime within the following year, possibly by his next birthday.
Whether or not you believe Elvis is alive, there is one point that can't be argued. Elvis Presley's level of fame is unequaled by any entertainer before or since, giving him an almost godlike status. And in the hearts of his fans, the King will always live.
Everybody wants him to be alive. They don't want to believe that King's dead. Elvis is larger now than he was when he was alive.
Sinead O'Connor, the renegade rock star with the face of an angel. Her story is now.